Are you hungry for knowledge? Well, if you are, this is the place to be. Today, this afternoon, I am in Charles Rockwood classroom here in the middle school, seventh grade classroom, and it's quiet in here now, but I get the idea it is bustling all day long because of the different exciting things that Charles does to help students learn here and beyond. So please join me as we sit down and have a talk together. Hello, Mr. Rockwood. Thank you for having me here in your classroom today.
Well, thank you for asking me to meet with you. And please call me Charles.
All right, Charles. Well, we should get going. There is so much going on. I can see just almost crawling off the walls of your classroom here. And I get the sense that that's part of who you are as well. There's a lot going on in life for you. And I'm curious to start. Hornswoggle, can you tell a little, why is that on your board today? Why is that part of you and your work?
Well, I'm so glad you asked. Hornswoggle is the word of the day. Every day there's a new word of the day. Sometimes I provide the word for students, or students themselves pick them out. They make suggestions. Mm. Hornswoggle is a word that I just like the sound of. Mm. When it's written, it looks unusual, and when you say it, it has a unique sound to it.
Yes. Yeah.
And the meaning of it is, what it may mean, something relatively simple, yet it can be used for as an alternate synonym for, say, dupe, for example.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, wouldn't life in Hopkinton be more interesting if we use that in our vocabulary around here? And so I should say that you are a teacher. What grade are you here at Hopkinton Middle School?
I'm a seventh grade teacher at HMS.
Mm-hmm. All right. And you have a lot popping off your boards. You're a teacher here. Can you tell a little bit about what's going on very briefly?
Okay, great. So I'm a seventh grade English language arts teacher. Mm-hmm. And in our classroom, we explore our language, mm-hmm. literal aspects of the language and figurative aspects of the language. Mm-hmm. We explore texts. We look at informational nonfiction, fiction, all the genres of fiction. Mm-hmm. And presently we're working on a Mark Twain novel, The Adventures of Tom Sawyer.
Wow. Well, I see there's literature and there's language all around me here applied in different ways. And I get the sense, I think if I were back in time in this classroom, it would be very exciting to have language come alive in that way. How long have you been teaching here?
This is my 10th year at Hopkinton Middle School. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I taught in Grafton prior to transitioning to Hopkinton, and I did teach in Hopkinton briefly before Grafton as a long-term sub, mm-hmm. as a reading specialist.
Uh-huh. And so you worked in Grafton, and what led you to teaching?
Well, people have said that I missed my calling. Mm. I worked in the corporate world for many years, and I traveled extensively as part of my position. I had to travel all over this great country and outside of the country into Canada, South America, Central America, Mexico. And if I was away for an extended period of time, I would usually offset that or make up that time at home, working out of a home office. Mm-hmm. So at times I work into the evening. Working in a home office, you can work varied hours, many different hours. Sometimes I work late into the night. And at times during the day, I may have been just relaxing. Mm-hmm. So I decided that I was going to try substitute teaching.
Mm-hmm. And so, this was after how many years of corporate work?
Well, I was still working.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
In the corporate world. But I had I was making my own schedule, working out of a home office. Mm-hmm. And I was able to work some days substituting. And I wanted to see what it was like. So I attempted it. And people at that point said to me, the way you interact with the students, they're engaged. You're not just a typical sub that comes in and sits there reading the newspaper. Not that we have any of those here in Hopkinton.
No. Okay.
But at the time, I'm talking about back in the late 90s.
Yeah.
And by 2007, I had obtained my licensure, mm-hmm. To teach. I did have to go back to school, Cheryl, and let's see, I had to take some additional courses. Mm-hmm. because I had graduated college back in 1988, so I'd been out of college for a while.
Yeah.
After college, prior to college, I was in the military for a while. I was in the United States Coast Guard.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you have certainly been around and
so to
come
speak.
To here in
yes.
the classroom from
yes.
the world.
A circuitous
really,
route, that's
length,
true.
Huh? That's and true. I imagine learned all kinds of things in that world. And do you see a connection to working in the corporate world, to being a teacher, the teacher that you are?
Well, absolutely, because I think I bring a perspective that's somewhat refreshing in that I haven't been a teacher all of my life, and I had that varied experience. So that's real-world experience for many of our students, and there is a big push today to prepare our students for careers, you know, college and career. Mm-hmm. So by having background in the corporate world, as well as working as a serviceman in the Coast Guard,
right.
I think I can speak to those fields and offer students something that they may not have the benefit of if I hadn't.
Mm. And you had mentioned earlier you were an educator and a trainer in your corporate work as well.
So. That's right. So when I worked in Green Mountain Coffee, for example, it was a fledgling company, you know, relatively small, only maybe 40 employees. Mm. And I was hired to take the brand into new markets. First into the New England market outside of Vermont, in Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, and New Hampshire. Maine, there was some presence in Maine. Mm. So brought the brand into those markets, obtained distributors, and taught the distributor's personnel on how to present the product to their end users.
Mm-hmm.
So relatively just bringing it from the grounds up.
Mm-hmm. Which could be challenging population and working with adults.
True. Mm-hmm. So it was train the trainer and get them prepared to sell the product, brand awareness. And from there, brought it into the New York market, and then Philadelphia and Chicago, and further out west into California, Los Angeles, and further north and south.
Wow.
Around the entire country, set up new markets, brought in regional managers to run those markets, and...
A very different life.
A different
but,
life.
But it seems like it fits in to where you are now as the next part of your path.
Right.
And you are a teacher here who sounds very devoted not only to teaching in the classroom, but you have a lot going on after school here.
Right. Many clubs are here at HMS. Mr. Keller and the rest of the administrative staff, is they're huge proponents of extracurricular activities.
Good.
Mr. Keller has put out to all students, if they're interested in any club, to write up a proposal, what the club would entail, and find a staff member who would be the club advisor.
Mm-hmm.
And many new clubs have sprung up as a result over the last few years. One club was the golf club.
Mm-hmm.
A sixth grader went to Mr. Keller with the proposal to start a golf club.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Keller said, sure, that's a great club to have here at HMS. Go around and see if you can find an adult staff member who would be your club advisor. Eventually they made their way to me and they said, Mr. Arco, would you be interested in being the club advisor for golf? I said, sure. And that was maybe 5 years ago, and it's grown from maybe 20 participants to today we had a sign up of over 50.
Wow. And what do you have, a different club every day of the week?
So that's the golf club. Now that meets every Tuesday starting in May until the end of the school year. It's only seven or eight sessions.
Mm-hmm.
And we go out and golf nine holes,
mm-hmm.
a nine-hole round. In addition to that, I'm also the club advisor for Community and Club. That's a community service club here.
Mm-hmm.
Students, all grade levels, participate. And we look for groups and agencies in the local community, such as Project Just Because and others. We've done the Respite Center. We've helped out with Michael's Run. We've done the run around Hopkinton. They've been on the course as course directors, community and club members have. We've done the Timlin, worked in the Timlin in June. So there's many things that the community and club members participate in. Mm-hmm. Right now, we're in the middle of a fundraiser for the Lymphoma and Leukemia Society. Mm-hmm. It's our Pennies for Patients drive.
Wow, so it's always something and different.
Something and different, yeah, and so. They've worked to support agencies and organizations outside of the local area. So it's first, it's locally, and then it goes out a little bit statewide and then maybe globally. Maybe 7 years ago, I think it was, there were hurricanes tornadoes in Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. And a couple of schools were leveled and they lost everything. I mean, many homes were lost, but schools were lost as well. And the students were about to start the new school year and they didn't have any supplies. So our students at the end of that school year, before the new school year started, any students who were cleaning lockers out, they had school supplies they wanted to donate, such as pencils, note cards, post-it notes, anything like that. They gathered and we shipped them over to the school in Oklahoma. Uh-huh.
That's great. So getting students to care beyond themselves and what's going on here.
And that's what the community teen club does.
Uh-huh. Is which support is very others. Important, lifelong learning.
That's right. That's mm-hmm. right.
They're, yeah.
And many of the community and club students here at the middle school, when they move on to the high school, there's a similar club that they're participating in.
Keep it going. Good.
And keep it going. Uh-huh. Right.
Wow. And I know it sounds like you're doing quite a bit. There are probably other clubs going on, and you have reputation for being a Friday morning spirited messenger on HCAM TV, is it?
Okay, so every Friday, there is a video announcement here, and it talks about things that have happened or things that are about to happen the following week. And
comes on in every classroom.
It comes in every classroom.
Yeah.
It's projected or presented in every classroom. Mm-hmm. So the segment that developed over time was Fun Fact Friday. It started off in the classroom. I had a fun fact. It was Fun Fact Friday. I used to have fun facts posted on the whiteboard for students in my classes. And then from there, it became something that one segment was, oh, you should do that on HMS Today. You should do a Fun Fact Friday. But that's when we were doing the announcements on Friday at the time. Then they moved to Tuesdays, then we went back to Fridays.
Ah, okay.
So I do them on mostly every Friday. Mm-hmm. And I do it with enthusiasm. And mm-hmm. sometimes I dress up in costumes. And I impersonate people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What's your favorite one that you've done?
My favorite one was during the presidential campaign last year, Bernie Sanders tweeted out four words that were in fact nouns, but he said that they were adjectives in the tweet.
Okay.
He said four adjectives to describe Wall Street are, and he listed them, mm-hmm. but they were really nouns. So I dressed up as like Gandalf,
mm-hmm. yeah.
from Lord of the Rings, but I put on eyeglasses and I put on Bernie's accent. So I spoke like Bernie.
Can you do that a little bit for a minute?
I thought I was gonna start a revolution, but boy, did I get burned.
Fantastic, thank you. So I see, you know, that kind of energy that you bring into Friday. You're waking kids up here, right? The students.
Right. Well,
and you're getting them perhaps to laugh or to wonder,
sure.
check the news.
Sure. they're pretty alert.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, so
in addition to community and club and the golf club, I also am a co-host of Homer Club, which is an after-school space for students. Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursdays,
yeah.
a quiet space. They can come in and work on assignments.
Oh,
so Mrs. McNally, who teaches foreign language, and I share the responsibility of co-advise Homework Club.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it runs from right after school, so at 1:50 till 3:30 on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Uh-huh.
So we're here. We assist students if they need any help with any assignments, or we just provide them with some resources, mm-hmm. tools that they might need to complete
their
assignments.
Which is very important for getting right. through school and having right. support like that. Did you like school as a kid? Where did you grow up?
I grew up in the city.
Of New York?
In Boston.
Boston. Mm-hmm.
And I did attend parochial school. Mm-hmm. I did like school once I was able to unlock the mystery of words. Mm-hmm. So I have slight dyslexia, and I, when I was in middle school, it was identified that I could read the words on the page, yet I wasn't comprehending what the words meant. And it took one teacher that figured that out.
Wow. A teacher you are indebted to?
Or yes.
Grateful
a nun.
To?
It was a nun. I went to parochial school.
All right.
So she realized that I couldn't make out what I was reading. I didn't understand it. So she actually gave me some skills and strategies and repeated short passages to read and then to summarize them and, you know, what was the main idea, what was the supporting details. So if it wasn't for her, I wouldn't have the love for reading that I have today.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a great story, and not everyone can say that. So you know firsthand the power of a great teacher.
That's
who
right.
Who sends you in a positive direction with learning.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's so important.
And so not only did you continue on in school, you end up teaching, and you're teaching in the area of literature as well.
Right.
And reading and writing as well. You are working in some areas of writing.
Absolutely.
I know poetry because I've been in this classroom and seen some of what goes on with poetry and getting the students excited.
Right, when you were in the classroom, we were working on a persona poem.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And
which was a lot of fun.
That was.
And
it
the
was
students
very,
were.
So this year, earlier in the school year, they wrote a winter haiku. Huh. And that was all their written work was displayed in the display case outside of the Brown Gym. Hmm. And they wrote a fall poem. So poetry is something that is woven into the curriculum throughout the course of the school year. It's not like a particular poetry unit. We might read a piece of text and then find a poem that's related to the text.
Yeah.
We read Russell Freeman's a portion of From Immigrant Kids, and then we read a poem by Nikki Giovanni about the kind of the Statue of Liberty. Mm-hmm. So it was related to the Ellis Islands, the people coming from Europe into Ellis Island. Mm-hmm.
So thinking about what's going on in the country, in the world, and assimilating it with literature.
True.
What's going on
right.
For a deeper understanding, I would say. And so what are you working on in your own writing?
Okay, in my own writing.
In your spare time.
I thought you were going to allude to the hair and the beard. So we'll get back. Let's get back to that.
All right.
So what I'm working on in my own writing, I have a couple of books in the I'm working on. Mm. One is nonfiction.
Uh-huh.
And
a book is no small thing, by the way, as you're telling me this. Two, not just one.
Right, and the other one is a fictional work.
Uh-huh.
And then I have a couple of short stories I'm working on in addition to poetry I write all the time. I enjoy writing poetry. Uh-huh. Sometimes poems just come into my head at any random time or at least a couple of lines of verse, and I'll hang on to them, and then I'll build off of those particular lines of verse.
And what makes you want to go forward and dedicate your time, your extra time, to in the area of writing?
Well, I've always, once the mystery of the words was unlocked, I have, at one time my mother used to say, a building could fall down around him while he's reading because he's so engaged in the work, in the literature, in the book. I always had a paperback book in my back pocket, so anytime that I found time, I would read. So as a reader, an avid reader, I also enjoy writing, and I like the nuances of the language. I like the way it can be written in various styles, and the voice of the author, and just the way words fit together to create meaning.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you're communicating ideas also, right?
And expressing and communicating ideas, sure.
And so you're doing this in your written projects, and then you're also stepping beyond that now in your new role in theater, which is not necessarily new also, I understand.
It's not that new as far as being involved in theater.
Yeah.
My initial foray into theater began in college. I had a college roommate who was a theater major, and they were performing in plays, and he asked me if I would be interested in coming on in a production of a Sean O'Casey play, just a walk-on. So I said, sure, why not? That introduced me to theater as far as being a performer. From then on, I continued in some additional plays. I wrote a one-act play, which we performed. And then I was involved in community theater for a while and ran a drama club similar to the club that Miss Gifford has here, a wonderful club that she runs here. Mm-hmm. I ran it at a high school nearby for 11 years.
Wow, and that's a long time.
Yet I was never involved in an actual musical.
New territory now, so, because you're going to be singing.
So Miss Gifford has cast me in a role of the upcoming spring musical. The musical is called Children of Eden. I play the role of father. And it's a story of family and love, and it's going to be produced, staged here at the middle school the last weekend of April.
Well, that sounds exciting.
And I do have to sing.
All right, can you give a little sample of a line?
A sample of a line?
Sing now.
Sing it, okay.
Why not?
Sleeping there like angels, innocent and simple, I think she's got my nose. I think he's got my dimple. In my own image, from my likeness, have they sprung. They will keep me company. They will keep me young.
Wow. How about that? Thank you for that sample. It sounds like a wonderful performance you are engaged in, and a show as well. And my interest is piqued. And there's
good.
Probably a cast of what?
Cast of 100? Thousands. No, over 100 anyway.
Over 100.
Between the students involved in, who actually are in the cast, and then all of the students behind the scenes. There's going to be sound effects and visuals and costumes, phenomenal costumes. It's worth taking in.
Wow.
Children of Eden.
And you are father of all the children.
Father, yes.
Okay. Well, stay tuned, everyone. It sounds like a really exciting program for the middle school.
It sure is.
And a little more expanding beyond for you in this path you are on, and teaching and beyond. And so when you have any extra time outside of teaching and all you're doing, you have a family?
Yes. So been married for 37 years. Mm-hmm. We have one son, Aaron. He is also a teacher.
Oh,
he teaches
wow.
Visually impaired children. Mm-hmm. And that's it for immediate family.
Yes, and how about your spare time then? What do you like to do for hobbies or interests beyond?
Well, I write.
Right, yes.
And
anything we don't know about you, maybe? And we're finding out.
Oh,
a lot.
I'm a beekeeper.
Well, there you go.
Beekeeper.
Does that take a lot
of time?
I
think some of my students know that. No, the bees do all the work.
Yeah, well, and it's important work to
Very
be
important.
Taking care of our honeybees in
That's
the world,
right? Absolutely.
And you gather the honey?
I haven't yet, so this is my second year.
Wow, okay.
I attended a course down at Norfolk Aggie. It was a 10-week course over the previous winter, not this past winter, the winter before. Mm-hmm. And I learned all about beekeeping, and in addition to my own, you know, discovery, taking out books and doing research online. And then I acquired the equipment.
Mm-hmm. And there you go. You're in this area.
Off and running.
Off and running. So what's on the bucket list? We have 2 minutes left. Anything in the future also that you're thinking about?
Have my books published.
Have your books published, yes. And where's been one of your greatest places in the world?
I'd like to go to Angkor Wat.
Where's that?
In Indonesia.
Indonesia.
It's a Buddhist temple.
Aha, uh-huh. Yes. Wow, that sounds like a good goal to look forward to as well.
Right.
And I guess, would you consider reading one of your poems as an ending for
Absolutely.
Now?
Absolutely.
Yes, I think we've covered a lot. You have a great deal of creative energy. And here's again a little sample of a poem, because you also have maple sugar.
Right. So this poem is about maple. Maple sugaring, boiling down the sap that's running this time of year. Mm-hmm. So in order for the maple, the sap to run, has to be cool nights, warm days. Mm-hmm. So you take off the buckets of sap, and then you boil it down. and it turns a nice color.
You put it on your pancakes.
And you put it on waffles, pancakes, or you just drink it right out of the bottle.
That's wonderful.
No, I'm kidding. So I have written a poem about an annual event that our family is involved in. We boil down sap every March, and we do sugar on snow, where you take some of the boiled down sap that's become maple
syrup. Like ice cream, right?
And you just splay it out onto fresh snow, and it's similar to ice cream.
Wonderful. Well, could you end by reading us your adventure of maple sugaring?
Okay. So this is a very short poem, but it's about maple sugaring. Air, crisp, clear, the smell of sugaring in the snow, ice everywhere. Trudging along toward the clearing, crossing the stream, locust wood making its steam, crystalline amber, ample, simple. I wonder who was the first to sample. Concentration, saturation, was it at maturation? Coaxing, coddling, continuing to boil, only 3/4 of a gallon? For all that toil?
Thank you. And happy maple sugaring to you and rest of the year here at the middle school and all your endeavors. Best wishes to you and to getting to Indonesia someday, perhaps, and getting your books out there. We'll stay tuned.
Thank you.
Maybe we'll hear it on the Friday news.
Do you have what it takes?
Will you make a difference?
Always an adventure.
Police and fire working together.
Utilizing the latest technology.
Do you have what it takes?